Recording in progress.
Hear me?
Yes.
Welcome. We rejoice that we can join in the worship of the Lord. May this time together strengthen us for the challenges we may encounter this week. Our introit hymn is number 27, As the Deer Pants for the Water, and we're singing verse 1 and the chorus. Please stand. Thank you. Call to worship. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Extol him, all you peoples. Steadfast love towards us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever.
Praise the Lord.
We lift our hearts and voices up in adoration and praise. With our chorus of praise, bless the Lord, O my soul.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Our prayer of approach, let us pray. Gracious God, we know love because you made it eternally visible in the person of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He revealed the depth of that love by laying down his life for us. We pray that our gratitude may be visible through our care for others and for this world in which we live. Jesus showed us that love was not confined to words alone, nor was it ever an abstract quality, but was at all times a heart-centered activity. Stir such love in our hearts, we pray, so that all we do may be pleasing to you and be the very best evidence of our identity as people with the risen Christ living within us, giving us life. As we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Our prayer of confession. We give thanks, most gracious God, for knowing love in its most sincere and beautiful form in Jesus, your Son, our Savior and Lord. He did not just tell people how to live, serving others, turning the other cheek, loving the unlovable. He demonstrated these things in the way he lived. And he warned us about some of the dangers we may be exposed to when he said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." We want to serve as Jesus served, but we confess that our priorities can become so easily confused by the values of the world, values which are usually in conflict with those spelled out by Jesus. He demonstrated that love was the priority of his life, enabling him to empty himself of any self-serving power and to lay down his life for all people, including us. We do want people to know that your love dwells in us and that we are true and active witnesses of that love, but you know how frequently we fail. Forgive us when our words and actions fail to disclose your love. Fill us anew with your Spirit, O God, so that our weakness is overcome by your strength, our selfishness is overcome by your generosity, and our apathy is replaced by your enthusiasm. In Jesus' name, amen. Our chorus of confession is, "Change my heart, O Lord." Our assurance of forgiveness. All who believe in the name of Jesus Christ and love one another live in him, and he lives in them. And there is salvation in no one else. Hear and believe the good news that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Our first reading comes from Acts chapter 4, verses 5 to 12.
Good morning. The next day, the Jewish leaders, the elders, and the teachers of the law gathered in Jerusalem. They met with the high priest, Annas, and with Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and the others who belonged to the high priest's family. They made the apostles stand before them and asked them, "How did you do this? What power do you have? Or whose name did you use?" Peter, full of the Holy Spirit, answered them, "Leaders of the people and elders, if we are being questioned today about the good deed done to the layman and how he was healed, then you should all know, and all the people of Israel should know, that this man stands here before you completely well through the power of the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified and whom God raised from the dead. Jesus is the one of whom the scripture says, 'The stone that you, the builders, despised, turned out to be the most important of all.' Salvation is to be found through him alone. In all the world, there is no one else whom God has given who can save us." The word of the Lord.
We'll now sing, "Our God is an Awesome God." Please remain seated. Our psalm today, Psalm number 23, "God is my shepherd and source of blessing." The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Our chorus, "Jesus, name above all names." Please remain seated.
Thank you.
Our epistle reading today is taken from 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 to 24. Love not just with words, but also with actions.
Good morning. This is how we know what love is. Christ gave his life for us. We too then ought to give our lives for others. If we are rich and see others in need, yet close our hearts against them, how can we claim that we love God? My children, our love should not be just words and talk. It must be true love, which shows itself in action. This then is how we will know that we belong to the truth. This is how we will be confident in God's presence. If our conscience condemns us, we know that God is greater than our conscience and that he knows everything. And so, my dear friends, if your conscience does not condemn us, we have courage in God's presence. We receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commands and do what pleases him. What he commands is that we believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as Christ commanded us. Those who obey God's commands live in union with God, and God lives in union with them. And because of the Spirit that God given us, we know that God lives in union with us. The word of the Lord.
We'll now sing the chorus, Refine Us Fire. Please stand. Please be seated. The gospel reading today is from John chapter 10, verses 11 to 18. Jesus is the good shepherd.
I am the good shepherd who is willing to die for the sheep. When the hired man, who is not a shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees a wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. So the wolf snatches the sheep and scatters them. The hired man runs away because he is only a hired man and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd. As the Father knows me and I know the Father, in the same way I know my sheep and they know me, and I am willing to die for them. There are other sheep which belong to me and are not in this sheep pen. I must bring them too. They will listen to my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. The Father loves me because I am willing to give up my life in order that I may receive it back again. No one takes my life away from me. I give it up of my own free will. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it back. This is what my Father has commanded me to do. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
We will now have special music by Kirsten.
Our land. Oh Lord.
Thank you, Kirsten. And yes, we do need him, especially in these days. We will now have the sermon by Elder Anna James.
Good morning. Special welcome to our visitors. It's actually third Sunday, which is, well, it was, morphed from a youth Sunday, where youth took charge of service, to contemporary Sunday. So we tend to do more worship songs rather than hymns, and you have the younger of the congregation leading worship. This is one of those Sundays. Our musician is not here, so we had to paddle along with instrumental music. So bear with us this morning, please. Thank you, technical team. This morning's reflection, it's not a sermon, is going to come from that favorite old psalm that we've done and said and repeated so many times in the past. Psalm 23. It's an age-old psalm. We've said it like 5,000 times. It's probably the first psalm that we learn when we're learning things in the Bible, especially psalms. And we may have visited it not too long ago. My sister did a beautiful sermon on it in my home church a couple of weeks ago, and I was very tempted to ask her to come and repeat it here this morning. But the responsibility was mine, so I stuck with the task. Psalm 23, our scripture readings this morning spoke about God's love, spoke about two different portions, spoke about God being the good shepherd. One of the scripture readings, the very first one, was a little different. We had a scenario where some of the apostles, Jesus had been crucified, was resurrected, and was standing before the Sanhedrin, being questioned about acts that they were performing. And the apostles ended by saying, "The stone that you rejected has now become the chief cornerstone." And that cornerstone we know is the Lord Jesus Christ. Psalm 23. It's pretty obvious. It follows a certain sequence. It's a short psalm by the psalmist David. And David here, is declaring God as the good shepherd. Having come out of a personal experience with God. So David begins the psalm with a very bold declaration. And you know, sometimes you start off making declarations by qualifying what you say at the beginning, and then you give the evidence right after. So Psalm 23 follows that sequence. David could not have written the psalm if he had not had a personal experience with God. So he's definitely speaking out of firsthand experience. The Lord is my shepherd. Now, the relationship that David had with God suggested to us that the relationship between David and God was sort of a father-son relationship, parent-child. The Lord is my shepherd. We did definitions of shepherd when I did Psalm 23 previously. Somebody who guides or directs a particular way. So a shepherd, The scriptures were written in such a way to make it relatable to the persons reading and interacting in those days. And you know, herdsmen and so on were common back in that part of the world. So they likened God to a physical shepherd. This person is guiding. This person is leading. Because that's what a shepherd does. The shepherd has a whole flock of sheep out in an open field, and the areas are sometimes enclosed when the shepherd keeps the sheep, and then when the shepherd has to take them out to pasture, the shepherd would open the gates and direct the sheep, lead the sheep and direct them with the staff, you know, that hooked rod that they hold and so on. You know, those things. So a shepherd does that. Shepherd takes care of sheep. And in our psalm today, David likens God to a shepherd taking care of him. So the second bold statement he makes, I lack nothing. I shall not want. Every single time I read that line in Psalm 23, it stumps me every single time. I shall not want. So David had an experience of God for years, and he concluded that coming out of that experience, he does not want anything. And I know sometimes in our own lives, we say there are needs and there are wants. We say needs are necessary, food, shelter, clothing, you know, basic things, and wants are the needs plus. So things that we just desire or would like to have. And here is David declaring in Psalm 23, I shall not want. To me, that's an extremely powerful statement. I shall not want. I shall lack nothing. If we take that portion of scripture and reflect on it, and reflect on our own relationship with God and our experience of God, we should be coming to the places we have, if we have not already done so, that in God we lack nothing. So I'm just thinking typical scenarios. A child grows up without a father, I lack nothing. A child grows up without a mother, I lack nothing. I have been sexually abused, I lack nothing. I'm poor and exposed, I lack nothing. I don't sit in high echelons in society and I'm being abused every day for whatever reason, I lack nothing. I feel stuck where I am, I can't have successful personal relationships, whatever it is, I lack nothing. So it says to me that God is a self-sufficient God. Back in the Old Testament, there is a whole slew of names for God. You know that. One of them is El Shaddai. God is all-sufficient. God is enough. Which means that whatever we're feeling, whatever it is we're dealing with, as long as we are walking in the will of God and doing God's will, we're supposed to lack nothing. We're supposed to need nothing. And that's something for us to think about this morning. Here is David declaring that he lacks nothing. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. You know what a pretty green pasture looks like. We may not have many pastures here. We have, well, you know, we have playing fields and so on. They're not pasture because sheep and so don't graze there necessarily. But you know what a good-looking, well-kept lawn looks like, or a well-kept pasture looks like. Pretty to look at, nice to sit and have a beautiful picnic in, whatever it is. David here is saying, he makes me lie down in green pastures. It kind of says something to me here. The pastures are greener. He didn't say he makes me to lie down in arid land, although I think he's capable of doing that too. It means two things here came out to me. David is lying down, which means he's absolutely comfortable, at total peace. He's not sitting, he's not leaning, he's lying, like body flat out, lying down in green pastures. It tells me there's a water source for that pasture. It's green. So there's something flowing into that pasture constantly that keeps it green and fresh. And this is David's source this morning, a God who constantly provides, gives him the courage, the strength, the confidence to lie down, become vulnerable because he's lying in green pastures. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. You know, still waters gives us that sense of tranquility. And it reminds us that when everything is happening around us that's crazy, that doesn't make sense, whether it's at work, whether it's family, whether it's children, problems, heartache, business, world wars, economic crashes, whatever is happening. He leads us beside still waters. David could have testified that the God that he was serving and experiencing was leading him beside still waters. I don't know about you, but I know for me that as I grow older, peace is an absolute necessity for me. As I grow older, I fight for my own peace. So things may be happening around me that may be chaotic or may disturb my peace. I either push through it, avoid it, step out of it, whatever it is, but peace. And the tranquility that David is speaking about is a peace that puts him in that place of serenity. I think this is everyone's goal and everyone's aspiration, to live a life of outer, but preferably inner peace. Inner peace. He restores my soul. So this is a God of restoration. He refreshes. He just provides constantly. He refreshes. I mean, if you were to reflect on Psalm 23, there are so many things you can get out of that psalm that would encourage us, that would encourage the Christian to stay focused on maintaining a deep relationship with God. Because there are benefits. There are many benefits. Though David walked through the valley of the shadow of death, or the valley of the shadow of darkness, he fears no evil. He didn't say, I am a little fearful. He said, no evil. No evil. It means if you feel wronged about something, it shouldn't be a big deal. Even when we get health news that we don't like to hear and it rocks our world, we are not to become fearful, because the God that David served is a God that walked with him in the shadow of darkness. And darkness could be anything for us. It could be child-given problems, family member committing suicide. Marital issues, children running away on drugs, all sorts of things. All sorts of evils. David's experience of God is that he will fear no evil. No evil. That's something for us to think about. He said the Lord is his rod and staff. Rod and staff. And I gave definition for rod before, the shepherd's staff. It is used to prod or goad the sheep. Prod or goad the sheep. So here's the shepherd looking ahead in pasture with the sheep. Seeing ahead, because that's the work of the shepherd. The shepherd doesn't stand on the side and open the gate and say, sheep, go on, go on, go on. Graze wherever you feel like grazing. The shepherd has eagle's eyes, scopes and canvases the whole area, sees the danger, way ahead of the sheep, and directs the sheep in the paths that they should go. Even when the sheep might be going down a precipice, the shepherd is still with them. Because it gets treacherous sometimes. But in one of our scripture readings, I think it was the last one today, in Gospel, it says, my sheep know my voice. David had to be connected with his God and so in tune to the voice of God that even when he faced, whether it was literal danger, he kept his peace because God was the one guiding him the whole time, all the way through and out of danger. The shepherd's staff is important. I took a note of here when I did the definition of prod. Use the prod or goad the sheep. Prod means to encourage to take action, especially when the person is slow or unwilling. So you can imagine the shepherd taking the staff and joking some sheep sometimes because one wants to veer off this way and the shepherd has a tough love. Mm-mm-mm-mm. This is the path you have to go. David had all of those experiences of God. And he was confident and comfortable knowing that God had his back. David was not a perfect man. We know the stories. There were many times he fell, but he always went before God with a contrite heart and made a U-turn back to God. The hook on the shepherd's staff is the ones that used, we're told, to take up fallen sheep. So a sheep may have veered across too much, somehow missed the shepherd's voice and start tumbling forward, and the hook is to pull the sheep back, which tells us the shepherd gives instructions, the shepherd expects the sheep to follow the instructions, but the shepherd is aware that not all the sheep will listen intently. Some may stray, and the shepherd is loving enough to pull back the falling or fallen sheep. That's something for us to think about as well. David concluded the psalm. I'm not going to go verse by verse, but David concluded that this shepherd will allow him to sit in the presence of his enemies and have a feast. Now, think about a picture of that. The shepherd leading you in a place where there is total, think of Daniel in the lion's den. There are ferocious animals left, right, and center waiting to eat you. And David sits still. He doesn't just sit still waiting for his God to work as God is accustomed working, but he sits and have a feast. That's crazy. That's actually crazy to fathom. He sits and has a feast. This, to me, is a demonstration of absolute, absolute confidence in his God. So David concludes by saying, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Brothers and sisters, this morning I want us to go away with, remind us again. Because, you know, we're human. We know those things, we forget. Or things happen and our faith gets shaky. Just like God was the shepherd, the good shepherd to David, we also can experience God in a similar way. Some of us can testify that God has been good. All of us actually can testify that God has been good to us. God has provided. God has healed. God has protected us from danger when we didn't even know the danger was around the corner or was coming. We ought to live in a state of thankfulness. We ought to live in a state of praise. We ought to stay connected and close to God so that we can hear and listen to his voice so that he can lead us like he led David. God has been tried, tested, and proven. It is on us this morning to tap into that power source that we so often don't make time to tap into and experience the power of God in our lives. Let us pray. Righteous God, we thank you for the Psalms of old. We thank you for the experiences of the people in the Bible. And we thank you for our own experiences which shape our faith in you. We bless you this morning. We lift you up. We magnify your righteous and holy name. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your provisions, great and small. We thank you for things we've never thanked you for. We thank you for protecting us, for keeping us, for your strength, your provisions. Encourage us today through your Spirit to dig deeper and have a more meaningful relationship with you so that we too can say, like the psalmist David, that the Lord is our shepherd with confidence, and we definitely shall not want. Keep us, Lord, guard our hearts, and give us the strength to love you the way you want us to love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Stand to sing our chorus of response, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. You may be seated. Our offertory prayer today is, let's have the offering and then we'll have the offertory prayer. So can two volunteers come forward to take the offering, please? We can pray for it before and after, but we'll pray after. Thank you. We'll now have our offertory prayer. In thanks for the great gift of Jesus' life within us, we bring this offering to be used to spread the good news of his love. We bring our lives also to be blessed anew by God, praying that the power that raised Jesus from the dead will enlighten our spirits and renew our dedication to witness to the gospel, not just in word and speech, but in truth and action. Amen. So everybody could stand back up now to give a testimony, because this is testimony time. So don't all stand at once. Anybody wants to share a testimony today about how God has been their shepherd and led and protected? No one? Amen. Anyone else? I want to thank the Lord for bringing us here today. We drove, we got here, we walked, nothing happened. So that's a testimony. One more? Anybody? Any testimonies from the back? Not today. Okay. At this point, I'd also like us to share. We share in celebrations, joys, and sorrow, and I believe we have lost a member of our family, Auntie Sandra's mom. So we just want to say reach out to her and tell her we love her and let her know that God is her comfort. The congregation is now invited to say sentence prayers. Thank you, Jesus, that you are so many things to us. And today we thank you that you are our comforter, our El Shaddai, our shepherd. And we thank you. Anyone? Anybody else wants to join in the congregation as we pray? Amen. We'll now say the Lord's Prayer. Our hymn of sending forth, number 376. Lord, the light of your love is shining. May we stand? benediction by Elder Anna James.
Now may the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that we may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
You may be seated.
We at this church are a loving, worshiping community, teaching others the love of Jesus Christ by example and through relational witness, facilitating others entering a reconciled, loving relationship with Christ. Wouldn't you like to make this church your home church and we your sisters and brothers? And today I see we have some guests. At this point, I would like to ask you if you'd like to introduce yourself to this family. One could speak for all. I didn't hear that part, sorry. Welcome and thank you, and I hope you find comfort in, you said you're here for a funeral? Yes, yes, so thank you. All right, we have birthdays, we have any birthdays this week? Anniversaries. Going to sing happy birthday today with no music today? Happy birthday to Gregory Dabriel. The announcement for this week, the first half of Reverend's vacation is from April 23rd to May the 7th. Choir practice as determined by Dr. Isaacs. The Rebuilding Fund collection is the fourth Sunday of every month. Our Bible study is every Thursday at 5 p.m. at the Felicity Julian Memorial Hall downstairs, the Kirk. And the CCG panel discussion is on April the 18th. Oh, that's gone. Any other announcements?
Good morning. I didn't hear the Ganpat family's announcement because you didn't have a mic. Your dad's funeral is tomorrow? Okay, at 1 o'clock. Okay. Please accept our condolences. We also have another family who's lost loved one. Marilyn and Derek's brother died this week. He was Larry. He actually was a musician with Cat Stevens. He was the son of our famous Unasteel. This family is extremely musical. So they're also in mourning. So we have a few people who are in mourning. Indian Arrival Day is always celebrated on the 1st of May, because on the 1st of May, 1857, the first boatload of Indians arrived here as indentured servants. And it is celebrated every year with a luncheon at Belmont Estate. I have tickets for those, if anybody's interested. There are also one or two who might need a ride up and down from there. So if you are interested in getting tickets, contact me. And if you are interested in getting a ride with somebody, contact me as well.
Thank you. We'll now have the recessional. It's love that makes the world go round. Can we stand? Know yourself made in the image of God, and may the peace of God be with you always. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.